Whatever you now find weird, ugly, uncomfortable, and nasty about a new medium will surely become its signature. CD distortion, the jitteriness of digital video, the crap sound of 8-bit, all these will be cherished and emulated as soon as they can be avoided. It's the sound of failure. So much of modern art is the sound of things going out of control, of a medium pushing to its limits and breaking apart. The distorted guitar sound is the sound of something too loud for the medium supposed to carry it. The blues singer with the cracked voice is the sound of an emotional cry too powerful for the throat that releases it. The excitement of grainy film, of bleached out black and white, is the excitement of witnessing events too momentous for the medium assigned to record them. Brian Eno, A Year with Swollen Appendices, Faber and Faber, 1996. Video games have come a long way since their arrival in popular culture. From Pong to Pac-Man to Perfect Dark to Persona 5, the advancements within the medium have been swift and stunning. Many games nowadays pride themselves on their photorealism, urging players to dig into every gritty detail of the images displayed before them. But as games have advanced further and further into these digital imitations of the real world, many developers have continued to make games that adhere to the aesthetics of old. That first line of the Brian Eno quote I just read, that whatever we find weird or ugly about a new medium will be cherished and emulated as soon as it can be avoided, really hits the nail on the head. Though we were once bound by the constraints of game engines and hardware that could only handle a few pixelated characters or pre-rendered backgrounds, our ability to transcend those boundaries allows us the means to mold them in our own image and create games that, while filled to the gills with myriad quality of life improvements brought about by modern game development, look, feel, and sound like the games we grew up with. If you look at the vocabulary we use to describe the modern gaming landscape, it becomes more than a little apparent that we view much of 21st century gaming through the lens of what came before it. You'll hear something described as a Doom clone, or a quote-unquote spiritual successor to games like System Shock or Half-Life. We even label whole genres by games that inspired them. We have roguelikes for games inspired by 1980s Rogue, and Metroidvanias for games styled after 1986 Metroid or Castlevania. These classifications sometimes even acting as adjectives to other game genres. In the past decade, we've seen retro-styled games like Hyperlight Drifter, Fez, Celeste, Strafe, Void Bastards, Project Warlock, Dusk, Dead Cells, Blasphemous, and titles like the recently announced Bomb Rush Cyberpunk carve out their own corner of the gaming landscape even amidst a sea of more, quote, modern titles. We've even seen modern amalgamations of multiple older titles, like the fan-made Sonic Roboblast 2, a 3D Sonic game built on the Doom 93 engine. So if we've always been thinking about these kind of vintage amusements, when exactly did our obsession with emulating them begin? Well, that's a little harder to pin down. I think, in a way, retro-feeling games have always been with us. We can look at a modern side-scroller like Blasphemous or a modern point-and-click like Roki and see the fingerprints of their predecessors, just as we can look at any number of modern FPS titles and see how they've drawn inspiration from games that came before. But I think the reductionist trap many of us often fall into is seeing all side-scrolling games as retro, or all point-and-click games as retro, since we perceive those to be some of the earliest established genres within the medium. As I was working on this script, my thoughts kept returning to two modern games, one you may have heard of and one that may be completely off your radar. The first game is Halo Infinite, the sixth title of the famed sci-fi shooter and the third developed by Microsoft-owned 343 Industries. And the second is the newest title from independent developer Virtuoso Neo Media, a seafaring dogfighter called Zodiac XX. Both titles are prime examples of the now blurred line between modern and retro games. Zodiac XX is a game so packed with character that it might as well be its own Super Smash Bros. Roster. Though the anti-fascist narrative is undeniably a product of the modern era, the art, gameplay, user interface, music, and sound design all scream the praises of an era of gaming long since gone from the spotlight. Zodiac XX is the type of game you'd write a Last Starfighter-style screenplay about. It's the kind of game you'd lose a whole night's worth of quarters to at the arcade. If you'd told me it was some lost Dreamcast title that had been resurrected and optimized for modern systems, I would have believed you. But it's not. It's a game from 2020. But while it may be obvious why Zodiac XX heavy metal, pop rock, jazz fusion, early Japanese import-inspired look and soundtrack might make one recall, perhaps, a classic Ace Combat or other turn-of-the-century dogfighting game, why would Halo Infinite spark thoughts of retro gaming in my mind? If you look back at the list I mentioned of retro-styled games published in the modern era, including Zodiac XX, you'll likely notice all of them are indies. What bearing does a next-gen AAA first-person shooter have on an analysis of retro games? Well, depending on when you're watching this video, you may have seen the recently released Halo Infinite gameplay footage that was shown off as part of the virtual Xbox showcase in June of 2020. The footage was very reminiscent in style of the early Halo titles, but once fans were able to pick apart the footage frame by frame, many were surprised by how the game actually looked up close. Halo has always been a franchise that has pushed the FPS genre forward, both in terms of gameplay and graphical fidelity, but it seemed to many that this most recent entry was a step backward, especially for a game that was set to release as part of the next generation of game consoles. Now, I'm not at all qualified to comment on whether or not that's true. I'm not an artist or a professional game developer, but I'll repeat what others more knowledgeable than I have said. Oftentimes, the discussion of graphics is really a discussion of art style. Graphics has become something of a blanket layman's term for the look of any given game, but what we're really talking about is the art style and art direction. If someone were to look at a game like Hyper Light Drifter and say that game has such bad graphics, purely because it's a pixel art game and the unfortunate game critiquer in question only likes photorealistic titles, their observation would be wrong. Now, what you might be more correctly able to say, though I don't think you should, is, I don't like the color palette in this section of the game, or I don't think this is good character design. These are actual criticisms, even if they lack validity. This game has bad graphics is more often than not an uninformed and incorrect observation of a given work of video game entertainment, rooted in a lack of knowledge of the medium. But what about Halo? From where I sit, it definitely feels like 343 is trying to get back to the mood and feeling of the original three Bungie-developed Halo games, with a nice coat of AAA polish. They have said in interviews after the release of that gameplay footage that the video players saw was not representative of the final look of the game, and more polish was yet to be done, even announcing in August of 2020 that the game was being delayed from 2020 to 2021. I'll go back to Brian Eno for a second here. Though Halo has often been at the forefront of pushing forward the limits of graphical fidelity, 343, free of the burdens of previous generations of console hardware, appears to have chosen to emulate an older, softer art style in order to more authentically capture that early Halo charm. In this regard, I'd say Halo 6 is the first retro Halo title. And please comment if you disagree, it's a win-win for me. If you don't comment, I'll assume you agree with me, and if you do comment, it will push this video further into the algorithm, only making me stronger. At some level, I think a lot of this comes down to nostalgia. Nostalgia is a big selling point, as should be obvious from the amount of re-releases and remasters we've seen hit the shelves as of late. The 2019 remaster of Link's Awakening or the 2020 Final Fantasy VII remake are direct attempts to cash in on this feeling. But I think our interest in retro-feeling games, at least in terms of original IPs like Hyper Light Drifter or Blasphemous, has to do with the texture and feeling of nostalgia. Do these games feel like the ones we knew growing up? The ones that caused us to fall in love with the medium in the first place? Do they sound like games we played as kids? As the medium continues to advance into next gen, we'll continue to see developers of all stripes making games like these, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. It's all about taking those things you loved and making them your own.
Hey everybody, this is Jake Terrio with Subpixel. If you've made it this far, hopefully it means you enjoyed that video that you just watched. So if you could leave a like and a comment and subscribe if you're not subscribed already, that lets us and our robot overlords at YouTube know that this video is worth watching. So thank you for that, and we'll see you next time.